speak, but I wanted to hear you talk. Alright? I'm selfish. If I'm going to be here, I want to hear people. I want to hear speak. These people have either helped me with how we do things at Showtime, with our athletes, with our adults, or I think that they'd be adding value to our seminar. Coach Marie, I met 2 years ago, correct? And we've just gone back and forth, and over the last summer we talked more and more. And I think what he's done with the Denison University Swim Program is one of the most remarkable turnarounds of a team, environment, culture. So that's what he's going to talk about, and you just won national title for men's, right? And then fourth for women's. Alright, so as far as Division III swimming, it's one of the most prestigious programs. You wouldn't coach of the year, but I see that. But he's very humble, so I'll brag about what he's done. So give a round of applause for Coach Marie.
Y'all hear me, Aaron?
Yeah.
My voice has gotten in lots of trouble over the years, whether it's in church or the back of a classroom, so never had a problem carrying, but morning. It's nice to be here. I really appreciated Nick extending an opportunity, an offer to come in and talk with you this morning. I just finished my 31st year of coaching at Denison. I went to Denison back in 1987 with a four-year plan, and I'm still working on it 31 years later. And you know, when Nick and I were talking about putting together a presentation, we got back to our conversations that we've had over the last several summers, which is just basically building and sustaining a championship culture. And I'm just going to share some thoughts with you today on it. I put together a PowerPoint. I'm admittedly old enough to hate PowerPoint. I think I do it just because that's what the young people do. I'm terrible at it. I basically suck at it. But I have some cool slides, and we'll just kind of roll through those at some point. But quite honestly, I prefer a more organic kind of conversation, a more give and take, back and forth. So feel free to stop me at any point. If I miss you, throw something at me. Raise a hand or something. But if you've got a question or you need clarification or want to push, because this is really your time. It's not my time. I want to make sure we're getting to the things that are important to you. Over the last 40 years, I come from a fairly successful family in that my father was not college educated, but worked his way out. He started out as a Class D tester at Sperry Corporation, which is about as low on the assembly line as you can in Long Island, and worked his way up to the point where he now owns, at the age of 86, soon to be 87, owns an aerospace company in Michigan. And without a college degree. My mother, who is 86, continues to work full time. So I come from a background of hard work. I come from a background where I was taught early that it doesn't matter what kind of degrees that you have or what your educational background is necessarily, but that your character counts more than anything. And so I've always prided myself on being able to work hard. I don't consider myself a particularly insightful or intelligent person, but I've gotten where I am just by rolling up my sleeves and getting busy. Along my process, I've made it a career of studying success and failure. I think there's two ways to address the question of developing a championship culture. Is you want to see what succeeds, but you can learn just as much by what doesn't work and what are the constants in both of those two equations. And so, like I said, I'm just going to share some thoughts with you today and stop me as we need to. So I got a question for you guys, just to start. All of you guys have invested some time and money in a Saturday morning, Saturday part of a Saturday afternoon to come to this seminar. My question to you is, why'd you come? Why did you come here? If you're writing down, I really want you to answer that question. When you saw the seminar posted, what was it that you were hoping to get out of this clinic? What were you hoping to get out of the seminar? Take a second just to think about it. And what was the one thing that really motivated you to come here today? Okay? And I'm just going to throw some possibilities up. Maybe it was you want to learn a new technique. Maybe you want to learn something about injury prevention. Maybe you want to learn something about peak performance. All those are legit. But you had a reason that you got up this morning, invested time and money to come here. I want you to look at your answer for just a second, and then peel that answer back. Peel off a couple layers and say, okay, what's behind that answer? Okay, maybe I wanted to come here and learn something about peak performance, but what's behind that answer? What's the motivation behind the answer? Is it a desire to excel? Is it a desire to be the very best? What's behind it? And that's really, and the answers to those questions are highly personal, but this really provides us with the foundation for where the rest of the conversation is going to go, is understanding why we're here to begin with and what we hope to get out of this, but what our key motivators are. Okay, so keep that just in mind as we kind of move forward here. Want to share just a quick anecdote. Over the years, I've had the opportunity to do a lot of presentations and sit on a lot of panels, a lot of Q&As and things like that. And about 20 years ago, I was in Provo, Utah at the World Swimming Clinic. All the best minds in the world were there. You know, we had representatives from the Soviet Union, we had representatives from China, Germany, Italy, France, Great Britain, Australia. The best swimming countries, the best swimming coaches in the world were there. I was humbled to be asked to participate on a panel that was going to discuss success in sprint programs. At that time, I had had my first Olympian, a young man out of Chicago, Illinois. His name was Darius Grigalunas. Darius came to us as a young man who couldn't even make it to the Illinois High School State Meet. And within 6 years, we had him standing on the podium in Athens, Greece, with a silver medal around his neck in the 100-meter freestyle. He went from a guy who was not even in the top 30 swimmers in the state of Illinois to being a swimmer who was in the top 30 in the world. And I don't take very much credit for what he did because it was really all Darius's work, but I had the good fortune of coattailing on his success to be asked to go to one of these panels. And so I'm sitting on this panel with some of these other coaches, and the question was, describe for us what you do with your sprinters. And I was the fourth in line. I was the young guy. There were some really big heavyweights on this particular panel. And we went from oldest to youngest, and I was the youngest. And I remember listening to Eddie Reese, who's now the coach at the University of Texas, describe what he was doing with the sprinters there. And then I listened to Vladimir Selnikov from the Soviet Union describe what they're doing in Russia with their sprinters. And then I can't remember the gentleman's name to my immediate left, but as I'm listening to them, what I heard was, we're all basically doing the same things. The what's, what we were training, how we were training, was all the same. And so when they finally got to me, I'm like, I got nothing to add. I mean, I'm just going to be redundant, and I'm just going to repeat everything that the last three coaches have said. And then finally, in the back of the room, it was a room about this size, but it was absolutely packed to the gills. Some frustrated woman stood up and just was completely, and she goes, I'm completely frustrated by this panel. I came here looking for new ideas and new answers, but all I'm hearing is, you guys are doing the exact same thing that I'm doing, but why are you up there and I'm back in the back of the theater? She goes, why are you having so much more success than I am? Because I'm doing the exact same sorts of things that you are. She goes, I'm training my kids just as long. I've got them in the water and in the weight room, and we're doing stretching. We're doing all the things that you've just described, yet you have Olympians and I don't. You have world record holders and I don't. Why? What's the difference? And honestly, it was the best question of the day because it made us all stop and pause for a second and say, yeah, why? Was it simply a matter of talent? Did we just have more talented kids? So it really launched, we really launched into a discussion as to why, you know, trying to answer that question. And what it all boiled, come on down, come on, we got, come on in. It's a user-friendly group. Glad to have you with us. But the idea was why did these four people up on the panel have much more success than that? And what it started to boil down to was simply this: context, culture, basically an ecosystem. I think it works. Does it work? Is it flipping? Okay. Doesn't flip up here? Maybe it does. I got it. There we go. I had to hit the computer anyway. So basically got down to culture. what she was discovering is that her team climate, her team culture was radically different than ours. What she found was that while the whats were different, the whys were extremely different. That the biggest difference between what we're experiencing with our athletes and what she was experiencing with her team was the reason why the swimmers were there to begin with. Now, what I'm sharing with you here is Simon Sinek's golden circle model. And I would encourage any of you who have not spent time with Simon Sinek, it's S-I-N-E-K, to do so. He's one of the great minds out there right now and helping us understand what motivates human behavior. He's made a lifelong commitment to understanding human behavior, human motivation, and in particular the challenges that are facing our current generation of millennials and those who teach, guide, coach, and mentor them. And I assume most of us are working with the millennial generation. Some of us are millennials. Yes? Is a millennial basically 1990 to the current? Is that basically how, is that about it? Is that to
my mid
year? Okay, all right, good. Well, I'm a baby boomer, so there you go. You know, anyway, yeah, I don't fall into the millennial group. But anyway, so what we got into is the whole concept of how does culture drive success? And basically the way we defined it was is that culture is a social ecosystem. Very much like you might have a biological ecosystem. This is a social ecosystem which unites people under a common cause and vision. Or, if we want to look at the inverse of that, basically disunites or separates people from having a common cause and vision. But if it's done well, if it's done as well as you can, basically what we've got is a community of thought, and it comes from a certain why. Now, what's interesting, I got up this morning. I'm an avid Detroit anything fan. Grew up in northern Michigan, so I'm a Pistons fan, I'm a Red Wings fan, I'm a Tigers fan, I'm a Lions fan. I even like the Michigan Panthers, who were the last football team, I think, in the USFL to win a championship. But anyway, that's how far back I go to Michigan. But I got up this morning, and I'm an avid reader of the Detroit Free Press. And there was an article in the sports section talking about Matt Patricia's first team meeting that he's going to be hosting with his team starting next week. Matt Patricia is the former defensive coordinator who was with the New England Patriots forever, ran arguably one of the best defensive schemes that we've seen in the NFL for 10 years. He was hired by the Detroit Lions this past fall or winter to take over the head coaching job. And I've made it a point of whenever I get a chance to read or watch or listen to Matt Patricia, he's just got some really brilliant ideas. He's got a degree in aerospace engineering. He's incredibly bright. But the interview was about the first meeting that he's going to have with his team coming up next week. And I thought it was really interesting. And Patricia's particularly transparent as a coach. Unlike Bill Belichick, who was, you know, like a wall, you don't get anything out of. Patricia is the exact opposite of that. If Belichick's an introvert, Patricia's the extrovert. And Patricia does whatever he can to connect with his players. He's known as a player's coach. The players love playing for him. They commonly comment on, you know, the fact that, you know, he feels like a father figure to him. So anyway, they're talking to Patricia yesterday about, you know, what's your first meeting going to be like? And he says, well, there's two things I want to get across to my team. He goes, first and foremost, I want them to know who I am. So I'm going to talk to them about my love of family. I'm going to talk to them about my love of Star Wars. I'm going to talk to them about my love of Lego. Those are the three passions in Matt Patricia's life: family, Star Wars, and Lego. He goes, but then I'm going to tell them about my next passion, and that is football. And I'm going to sit down and share with them why I think being a great football team is important, and why coming together as a team is important. Because he goes, the better I communicate my passion, my dream, my vision for my football team, the better we'll be as a football team. What Matt Patricia is getting to is exactly what we're seeing here, is that the why we're doing this is at the core of everything that we're about as coaches, teachers, mentors. Okay? And it really gets down to this, and this is why is important. Why we're here this morning. Why you chose to come to this clinic. Okay? And it gets down to this, is that people don't buy what you do. They buy why you do it. This is really important. Go back to the conversation that I had with that coach back in Provo, Utah. If the two of us were competing for, let's say, a recruit, let's say the two of us were trying to get to the trying to lure a swimmer to our program, communicating to that swimmer why we're doing it. Now remember, we're all doing the same things, but there was a distinctive why difference in the why we're both there. But the reality is that most athletes, most lifters, most people of success are not necessarily interested in what you're doing, but why you're doing it. I've got two examples here, you know, that I've drawn out over the years. One is the New England Patriots, and the other is Apple Incorporated. Apple is arguably the most successful computer company in the world. Okay? So what they do, if I go back for a second, what they do is make computers. And they make phones. They make a lot of different things. How they do it is that they have great engineers all along the way. But why do they do it? Because Apple's mission statement, if you go back, is they are committed to being the most innovative, let's say, non-status quo computer company in the world. That's their mission statement. They're not just interested in building computers. What they're interested in doing is breaking down barriers, breaking down mental barriers, sociological barriers, and doing it through a computer means. That's what, and so anybody who's drawn to an Apple is going to be, an Apple product is going to be drawn to that message. There's all sorts of computers out there that are available to us, but Apple wins simply because they've got a better message as to why we should buy their product. And take that versus a Dell. Now the Dell computer may be just as good as the Macintosh, but the way that they message to us is a little different. Dell basically says, hey, we've got great computers, come buy one. That's not a particularly sexy message. Apple, on the other side, says, listen, we happen to be a company that's really innovative. We're trying to break social barriers down. We're trying to be on top of things and on the cutting edge of things. Oh, and we also happen to make computers. One is a more attractive message than the other. So the important, What I'm trying to communicate here is that basically we want to be, as coaches, mentors, and as teachers, we want to be communicating our motivations to our clients to make sure that we're getting the right people. Okay, so what's your cause, what's your purpose? The goal is to build culture with people, not with people who do what you do. The goal is to build culture with people who believe what you believe. So going back to the conversation I had with that woman in Provo, Utah, what it got down to, she finally asked me, she goes, so what motivates your athletes? Why do athletes come to Denison? Why did Darius choose to come to Denison? And I said, very simply, because I pointed this out to him. I said, what we're trying to do at Denison is we're trying to establish a unique fingerprint in the world of swimming. What we're trying to do, we're a small liberal arts school, highly competitive academically. And for a lot of swimmers, that's great. But if we want the great swimmer, what we also have to do is say, listen, you can come to Denison, you can get a really good education, but we're also going to set you up to become a world beater in the pool. Now, most small schools, most small colleges don't send that message. Too often in our way of thinking, and this is probably true, if you look at the NCAA, Division I is always considered the big time. Division II is a notch below, and Division III is somewhere down here. Division III swimming is the redheaded stepchild of the NCAA. Okay? And that's pretty much the mindset that our clients, our swimmers, our athletes have been exposed to. When you turn on the app, when you turn on the television on a fall afternoon, on Saturday afternoon, during the fall, you don't see Williams playing Amherst in football. You'll see Ohio State playing Michigan. You'll see UCLA playing USC. If you turn on the television on Sunday afternoon during the winter, you'll see Duke, North Carolina, basketball. You will not see Otterbein playing Denison. You will not see Capital playing Mount Union. Well, you might see Mount Union football on there, but the point is Division III is off everybody's radar. So if we want to become a championship team, if we want to be special, then we're going to have to send a very special message. And our message at Denison has been really, really simple. And this is what I tell our recruits and our swimmers all the time. Just because you happen to go to a small school in Central Ohio that is academically highly competitive, that should not disqualify you from pursuing your Olympic dreams to the nth degree. We just happen to believe that being a smaller school is an advantage when it comes to developing great swimmers. And I can list about 10 different reasons why that's true. Because most swimming programs in the Big Ten are overlooked. I remember when I was an assistant coach in the Big Ten, we had the Big Ten champion in the sprint freestyles, a girl by the name of Mary Roslin. She went out and set Big Ten records in the 50 and 100 freestyles at the Big Ten championships that year. It was the first conference championship in those events in Michigan State history. It was a big deal. I mean, we were beside ourselves that we finally had crowned some, you know, beat all the Ohio State, beat the Michigan, beat the Indiana, beat the Minnesota women and everything like that. So when we got back to East Lansing and we opened up the newspaper, we thought it was going to be front page news. We had to get to page 8 before we had this little clipping about Mary's conference championships. Because on the front page, Scott Skiles, some of you might remember Scott Skiles, great point guard from Michigan State. There was a full on the front page of the sports things was about Scott Skiles' DUI that weekend. So swimming is not on anybody's, let's say, radar to begin with. But if we wanted to develop a culture that was unique to the swimmer, we had to send a very different message. That not only were we a unique small college swimming program, but we were comparable to any Division I, Division II message. Now, some people might say, well, yeah, that's folly. You can't beat Ohio State. You can't beat Michigan. Sure, I know that. We can't beat Michigan, and we can't beat Ohio State in dual meet. We swim Ohio State every year. And Bill Dorencott, who's the coach there, takes it easy on us, and he still beats us by 100 points. But the point is, is we don't roll over, and we feel like we belong, and we send the message to our kids that just because they're at a small school, that should not disqualify them from pursuing their Olympic dreams. And quite honestly, that's why I get up every morning at 4 o'clock and go to work. I get up every morning at 4 o'clock because I want those kids chasing their Olympic dreams. Now, I've been coaching for 31 years. I've had probably over 1,000 swimmers come through my door, and I've had one Olympian. Just one. I'm not making, they're hard to make. They're really, really hard to make. So I'm batting one out of 1,000. That doesn't get me out of the dugout in a baseball game. But the point is, that doesn't dissuade our swimmers from pursuing the dream because we all believe that the dream is possible. It's a hard dream, it's a reach, but it's worth pursuing. And what we're trying to do is instill that. And that's why when we sit down with athletes, the kind of athletes that we're getting to Denison and in our swimming program are kids who believe in that, who believe what I believe, that you can be a superior student, that you can go to a small school in the Welsh Hills of Ohio, and you can make it to the Olympic Games. That's why they come to Denison. Because it's not because our training's any different than Ohio State. It's not that it's different than any other small school around the country. We're all basically doing the same. But the ethos, the team culture, the team message is what distinguishes us. So my why, which is to basically unleash the potential of these really great student athletes, has to be present in my attitude and, most important, in my behavior and choice every single day. So when I walk in onto that pool deck in the morning, or when I walk into the weight room in the morning, we know why we're there. We're training for something bigger. Now, it's interesting. Share a quick handle. I have a swimmer by the name of John Geisinger. John's about about that tall. He had little baby hands. He had the smallest hands I've ever seen. And he had little tiny feet. The tiniest feet ever. Now, those are not things that go well with swimmers. Okay, swimmers generally, if you think about Phelps, if you think about Lochte, even somebody like Katie Ledecky, they're big people. The average height of the U.S. Olympic woman swimmer this year was 6'2", back in 2016. 6'2", that's the average. The average guy is 6'5". That's the average, okay? But John was, this tall, little baby hands, little baby feet. And went out, despite his physiological and physical and anatomical challenges, his senior year posted the 8th fastest relay split in the country, Division I, Division II, or Division III. Despite all of his weaknesses, apparent weaknesses, had the 8th fastest 100-yard freestyle split in the country that year. And I remember talking to him after, we were doing a senior exit interview, and I said, John, tell me about your Denison swimming experience. What made it unique? And his brother swam at University of Virginia, and, in the big time. Virginia's a pretty big time. He goes, Coach, it really boils down to this. He goes, what student at Denison wakes up every morning with a greater sense of purpose than we do? We get to wake up every morning and do something that we truly love, pursue a dream which may be pie in the sky, and we get to do it with the people that we love the most on this earth. Now, if you've created a gym culture, a training culture like that, you're going to be successful. I was ready to retire right then. I'm like, okay, I'm done. Okay, I've reached the finish line. I can quit now. I can die. We finally figured it out. Well, then next year, seniors came in and crapped all over that one. But anyway, the point being, there is no finish line. But the point is that it's the culture that dictates our success. And really, it gets down to the last line on the screen. I can't even tell what's up there. But inspired leaders work from the inside out rather than from the outside in. That as a coach, teacher, mentor, your focus needs to be on why you're doing it. What's at your core beliefs? Why are you in this game to begin with? And that's probably the most important question, because the hows and the whats are much easier. Those are easy. You can pick up a textbook, and I mean, granted, there's lots of innovation and stuff like that. You're here to, during the rest of the day, you'll learn more about the hows and the whats, but the why is what drives the success of your culture. It's not the hows and the whats. Those are peripheral things. Those are reflections of something that is much more important, which is namely why you're doing it to begin with. Okay. Did it flip up there? It did. Okay. So this is a paraphrase of something that Simon Sinek said. If you don't know why you do what you do, how can you possibly expect people to buy into what you do? Or better yet, follow you and or be loyal to you. So the point is, are you sharing your why with your clients? Are you sharing your why with your teammates? Are you sharing your why with your athletes? Do they know why you're there? When I finally started to share my vision of what I wanted Denison to be, all of a sudden, some really cool things started to happen. Kids got to know me better, I got to know them better, and we all were on the same page, and it really eliminated a lot of the second guessing and a lot of the question marks. But to share why, first off, before you can share why, you got to spend some time with yourself. You got to ask some hard questions. Why am I into this? And not all motivations are equal. You know, some of us are into this for making money. That's okay, though. Nothing wrong with making money. These are not mutually exclusive. Some are just into it because they want to help, you know, young people kind of transition into adolescence. Some people are into it for peak performance. Some people are looking for a pal. Some people are looking to try to make friends through all this. All of those are legit. All of those are prevalent in my life. But really, why I'm in this game is I'm intrigued with peak performance. When you get right down to it, what drives me is the idea of taking, let's say, underdogs, Division III athletes who don't have all the physical attributes that go, my average woman on my swimming team is 5'6", 8 inches shorter than the Olympian. And the men are about 5'10", 5'11", that's my average height. Darius is only 6 feet tall. It was so funny because Darius went to the Olympic Games and he was on the Lithuanian 400 free relay that got second that year. And he swam with a couple other guys, and my favorite was Rolandis Gambutis, who was 6'11". Okay? And so Darius is 6 feet tall. There's a great picture of them on the podium. It's like Rolandis and Darius and Anton, and then there's like my Darius down here. It was ridiculous. But, you know, there's like an 11-inch difference between Rolandis and Darius. And the point is my why is taking young men and young women who don't have all the physical attributes of an Olympic swimmer, who are highly academically oriented, and trying to turn them into world beaters. It's a tall order, but that's why I get up every morning. And I convey that idea to my swimmers. Now, knowing your why is different than sharing it. And sharing it means that you got to be willing to be vulnerable with your athletes. It means you got to get out on the floor, you got to get out of the office, you got to put the phone down, you got to get out, you got to get in the trenches with your athletes, and you got to share with them why you're there to begin with, why it's important. Now, it's really interesting. I'm the father of 6 sons. My oldest son is 31 years old, he's Andrew, and now we go from 31, what's going on there? I think we just went back. That's it, but we're good? Cool. So anyway, this is interesting. I've got a 13-year-old son, his name is Simon, he's a hockey player, he's a pretty good hockey player. And he used to go to a gym, I won't mention names here at all. We went to a gym in Central Ohio. We'll just describe it as that. And it was highly impersonal. The coaches were, you know, kind of kept their distance from the athletes. They clearly had their favorites. Simon wasn't one of them because he wasn't a football player. He was a hockey player. Good hockey player, good size kid. And Simon was just, you know, remember, we went through the training. The training looked sound. It was developmentally appropriate. There was nothing wrong with what he was doing, but there was something missing in the why. And Simon, and he would go through some good workouts, but I could tell just watching him that he just wasn't pushing himself very much. And most important, he just wasn't smiling. Here's a, here at the time was an 11, 12-year-old kid doing these dry run exercises and, you know, doing lunges and doing these balancing things. And the kid was just miserable. And I said, you know, hey, we've got to look for something else because this is not worth it. This is not worth the time or the energy. And I don't want this to be a negative experience for you. So meanwhile, son number five, Gabriel, had been working with Nick. And Gabe's now in the Air Force doing some really cool work. EOD specialist, which we're very proud of. But Gabe was having this wonderful experience with Nick Shelton. And so Gabe said, well, why don't you take Simon over with Nick? He goes, Nick's a pretty relaxed guy. He'll reach out to Simon. So we brought Simon in to Nick's gym. Now, the exercises that Nick and his staff were doing with Simon were the exact same. I mean, you could have put one right over the top of the other, it looked like a perfect match. But there was a difference. Nick reached out to Simon. His staff reached out to Simon. They knew his name. They were interested in how this, you know, they talked to him about his hockey. They took a vested interest in it. And then all of a sudden, Simon's got this big beaming smile on his face. Because Nick's staff had done a really good job of communicating their passion for working with young people. And that made all the difference in Simon wanting to be in that gym. And now he can't wait to go. Because Nick and his staff had done a great job of being vulnerable with their clients, with the people that were coming in the door, and it made all the difference. And I've watched Nick now for a few years, and he does it with all age groups. It can be with the retired octogenarian, or it can be the 8-year-old kid who's just trying to figure out if they can walk a straight line. It doesn't matter. Nick takes an interest in them, and that's why his gym is being successful. It's a great model for all of us. That's why I enjoy going there and learning and watching him do that. So anyway, knowing your why is important. Sharing it with your athletes is important. So what is your why? My experience is that most of us sell ourselves way too short. Most of us don't reach far enough. Most of us play it safe. But have a vision, think big, or don't. Or don't. And if you don't, well, your clients are going to pick up on that. Your teammates are going to pick up on that. And chances are that your clients and your teammates won't be around very often. Or, worse yet, you're going to attract all the worst clients and all the worst teammates. So whatever message you're sending is going to be a magnet. That message has power. It's going to be a magnet. Just depends on what message you're sending and who it's going to attract. So I share this with my team all the time. This is the invitation. And I don't have to repeat it for you. My mom would be disappointed if I did. But go forth and be a force of awesome. But reach. And it starts with us as the coaches, as the teachers, and the mentors. If we don't have a clear vision, if we're not pushing ourselves, how can we possibly ask our athletes and clients to push themselves? If we're not setting the example, how can we expect them to do it? Because coaches, teachers, and athletes, or coaches, teachers, and mentors, let's face it, we're the pace setters. We are the pace setters. We should be, at least. We shouldn't be taking our cues from, let's say, well, I mean, we shouldn't be letting our clients set the pace necessarily. We should be out in front of them, pointing to them where the horizon is, where the opportunity is. It's on occasion, and I have to share this, I've had a couple athletes over the years who have actually been my pace setter. It's a little embarrassing when one of the athletes comes in and talks to you and says, Coach, you're just not pushing me hard enough. Oh, God, that hurts. Really? I thought I was a tough guy. You know, I thought I was on top of this. I thought I saw it. But occasionally you're gonna run into an athlete who sees more than you do, who dreams a little bigger than you do, who's got a clearer vision of the possibilities. Darius was one of those guys for me. I've got another guy on my team right now who's like that. Just as like, he's a distance athlete. I mean, and just, hey coach, I know you only want me on, I know we don't have a lot of swimming background in this room right now, but you know, our workouts will go anywhere from, you know, we'll swim usually about 8,000 to 10,000 yards in a session, which is probably about 6 miles would be a good distance practice for us. And he came in, he said, coach, I know you've only got like 9,000 yards set up for today, but I've got this 20,000 yard set that I'd like to do. I'm like, Matt, we're gonna be here for 4.5 hours. Doesn't that sound great? And I'm like, okay, if you want to go up down that pool, I'm looking at a black line for the next 4.5 hours, let's get to it. But I was kind of embarrassed because he had a vision. He saw something that I didn't see. And Matt is going to be a senior next year for us, and he's gone from a non-Minnesota high school state qualifier, couldn't even make it to the Minnesota high school state state meet, to right now he's on the cusp of U.S. Olympic trials in just 3 years. Because he's got a clearer vision sometimes than I do of what's possible. So I'm learning from my athletes that way. But, you know, more often than not, we should be setting the pace. And that's why it's important that we're surrounding ourselves with people who are better than us, who see more. Because if we're just hanging around with the crowd, then that's not where the innovation comes from. You got to get out on the edge of your crowd to find out where the innovation is. That's where the forward thinking is. So, sharing your why, certain trumpet. I think I wrote this. But anyway, I don't necessarily need to read it to you, but successful leaders need to understand their followers more than the followers need to understand them. You need to know who you're preaching to, so to speak. But don't be afraid of standing alone and looking ridiculous. I think that that's a really important thing. If you go back and look at Steve Jobs' life, if you look at the people who are truly innovators in their fields, whether it's in Apple or whether it's Bill Belichick, they're always described as a little radical, a little weird, a little different. They're outliers. And so, If you're a forward thinker, understand that most of society is going to look at you as a little bit crazy, a little nuts. Don't be afraid of looking ridiculous, as long as your dream and your thinking is sound. Because the masses are way behind. If you're looking for social acknowledgement, recognition, then preach. You know, stay with the masses. But if you're interested in innovation and cutting edge stuff, you're going to have to leave the crowd. You're going to have to be willing to walk, at times, a very lonely walk. Because most people won't get it. Most people are going to look at you as like, dude's weird. Dude's really weird. He's going to the beat of a different drum. In fact, you know, we're going to the waltz and he's in reggae kind of a deal. But you got to be willing to live there. You got to be willing to live there. That's where the cutting edge is. I don't know if I can pull this up. Let's see if I can. But I want to. Can I get to this? Go to the web. Okay. I don't know if I can. What I want to do. Can I do that? You think there's a short video I want to show everybody? This is a really cool video I want to show you. One of the best videos on finding the right people. Really? You gotta be kidding. There's nothing risque, I can tell you. Okay, so. Sir. This is Derek Sievers. It's a very short video. Okay, we're having a hard time with the audio. So let me describe what's going on. There's obviously a concert going on, and we've got one guy out there who's just digging to the music. He's just having a great time. He is the leader. And soon, within about a minute, some other dude comes over and starts dancing with him, having a great time. Now, but understand there's two guys dancing on the hill, and there's not very many. The masses aren't there yet, because it's still not cool to dance on the hill with this music. Okay, and these guys are having a great time. But just watch what's happening. Just continue to watch what's happening. You've got one guy with a great idea. And then you got another guy who's like, that's a really cool idea. I want to go out and have some fun with that guy. So we're going to watch what starts to happen. Then a third guy comes in. And they're having a good time. And I mean, I have no idea what kind of drugs are on or what kind of music they're on, but they're having a great time. I wish I could have this much fun. But now there's a third guy there, and now a fourth, and now a fifth. And now we're starting to build some momentum. This one guy with this one lone nut with a great idea has now got a following. But at first, it was just one lone nut. One guy with a crazy idea, and now we've got a lot of momentum going. So now it's like, if I don't join in, I've got a problem. And the next thing you know is the whole concert comes to this hill. The whole audience comes to this hill. And now all the guys with the nice shirts start coming. All the guys who are dressed casually, you know. The next thing you know is you've gone from one guy with a crazy idea to one follower who followed, to now you've got a movement. And now everybody's behind you. And everybody's having a really good time. I would recommend that you find this on YouTube. First Follower Leadership Lessons from a Dancing Guy. Derek Sievers does a really good job of narrating this. It's a TED talk, it lasts about 10 minutes maybe. But you can see what's happened is the whole crowd has jumped in now. With one crazy idea, one courageous follower, and the next thing you know is you have an entire movement behind you. But it started with a crazy idea.
What was
the guy's name? Derek Sievers, S-I-V-E-R-S. Sievers, Sievers, I've heard it pronounced both ways. Really, really bright guy. But this is one of my favorite videos. I show this to my team every year. They love it. They think it's just the coolest thing ever. But here's the key thing. Here's the thing. And this is important because we're all leaders here, coaches, teachers, mentors, you're not nearly as important as the first follower. Right now, as coach, teacher, mentor, you're that guy out on the hill dancing. You're not nearly as important as the first follower, because the first follower, the first person who buys into your vision, is the catalyst for everybody buying in. Now, at the risk of not wanting to proselytize, if you go back to just the Christian tradition, Jesus was the focus, was the center of the church. But who started it? Had to have a first follower, Peter. Peter was, that's the rock on which I will build my church. The first follower is the key. So having the right first follower is the most important thing. So all sorts of examples here, but you're, as leader, you're not nearly as important as the follower. Or the first couple followers. So in order to get a follower, you have to sell your goods. You have to explain why you're there to begin with. Having a strong why will solve all the what's and all the how's. Okay, so I'm not going to bore you with this, because this is more Dennison related. But getting the right people who share our goals, who share our visions, who embrace our vision, and share our values is the key. You will find followers who are going to be willing to climb up the mountain with you. Okay? But there's another side to this, too. And this is really important, as I found it. And I've made this, and I'm drawing on my own mistakes here. There's some who won't. There's going to be some people who are going to want to follow you who you don't want to have any business with because they're not the right follower. And it's really important that you have a discerning eye in mind. I had this conversation with one of my coaches just yesterday because he's trying to build part of our program right now. And he's got some dead weight within the program. And he's beating his brain against the wall trying to figure out, how do I get these kids, move these kids along? And I said, well, maybe they're the wrong kids. He goes, well, what do you mean? I said, well, if every kid out there can fit into your program, then you suck as a coach. What do you mean by that? I said, your program should be elite enough, your message should be clear enough that not every athlete will fit into your program. You want an elite athlete, somebody has a very clear vision. Not everybody is going to be able to follow your vision if it's clear. But if you're all things to all people, then I'm guessing that you're going to be a pretty average coach. I mean, if you think about it, you guys are familiar with the movie Dodgeball? Average Joe? Remember the scene at the end of the movie when, I can't remember the character's name, but he comes out and goes, yeah, okay, so you might want to lose a few pounds, you can come to my gym, or you might want to be an elite athlete, you can come to my gym. Well, you know, that's why it's called Average Joe's. He's going to take the top and he's going to take the bottom. Well, that's okay. There's nothing wrong with being an average Joe. Just know what your why is. If your why is to appeal to all clients, then great. If your appeal is to, let's say, work with the octogenarian, the retired octogenarian, that's great. If there's room for you in your business or in your gym for that, that's terrific. If it's working with young kids, that's terrific. If, on the other hand, you're trying to carve out a particular niche of elitism or an exclusive kind of athlete, then you need to know that. And there's nothing wrong with having stratified motivations within your business or within your gym. You can have a place for octogenarians. You can have people like, you know, for arthritic, you know, 60-year-olds like me. Or you can have places for five, you know, for 8-year-olds too. That's all good. My point is not everybody's a perfect fit for your program. So don't be afraid to say no. If somebody's not fitting in, don't be afraid to say no. Okay? So where do you draw the line when it comes to sacrificing character for superior talent? I wish I had $100 for every time I made this mistake. Talent is very seductive. Talent is very seductive. Undisciplined talent is probably, unfortunately, has become the norm in many cases. But I have sacrificed team success simply to keep a superior talent in the program in the hope I could get that talent to turn around. Yeah, I've caused other athletes to suffer simply because I got caught up in the allure of dealing with a really talented athlete. It doesn't pay. Because ultimately, character wins, talent doesn't, when it comes to building team culture, okay? Balancing that out is pretty tough. It's very, very tough. So, how many of you are familiar with the phrase, we'll make the boat go faster? How many of you are familiar with the British eight, the story of the 2000 British Olympic rowing team, the eights? You guys familiar with this? Fascinating story. It won't take but a minute. And if I'm telling, how am I doing on time? I'm doing okay? I'm doing all right? Okay, perfect. Good. I could go for hours, so, but I won't tell you about it anyway. Okay, so the British Eights. Great story. And there's a book out there by a man by the name of Ben Hunt Davis. And he was actually a member of that team. And the British Eights. British have always been great rowers, but they've hit a real kind of a lull. They hit kind of a plateau, a mesa, however you want to say it, and they were struggling to be successful as a group. And In 1998, they had aspirations to try to win the gold medal in 2000. And they came up with a mantra that basically, in turn, and this gets to they knew what they wanted to do. Their motivation, their why was to win the gold medal. But identifying the how was very different. Okay, so if we know why we're here, then what's the how? What's that going to look like? And as Ben tells the story, he goes, we came from such various different backgrounds. We all came from, when you're putting together an Olympic group like this, you're drawing from different rowing clubs. They don't come out of the same community. They don't come out of the same socioeconomic background. They come out of very different value systems. There's cultural clashes and things like that. And they were having a very difficult time getting on the same page. They had some guys who were really hyper-disciplined, and they had some guys who were drinking pints right before practice. They had some guys showing up at practice hungover. They had some guys getting drunk on the boat. They couldn't agree with anything. And so they had a meeting, and Ben Hunt tells the story much better than I do, but they had a meeting. I said, okay, how are we going to decide what's acceptable and what's not? And somebody in the room said, well, I think it should just get down to this. Will our daily choices make the boat go faster? Will it make the boat go faster? So basically the coach might put out there, okay, we're going to spend 70 minutes on the rowing ergometer today. The question then in the athletes is, will that make the boat go faster? Yes. Okay? Then somebody came up with the idea, we're going to go down to the bars right before practice today, throw back a few pints, just so we, stay loose. Will that make the boat go faster? No. We're not going to the bar. Okay, well, we're going to talk about sleep. We're going to talk about nutrition. We're going to talk about training. Whenever they collectively or individually got to that fork in the road, the most important question on how they were going to proceed got back to that question, will it make the boat go faster? So that there was alignment, there was agreement in how they were going to conduct themselves. I would encourage you to read this story. It's a good book. You can get it on audio. It's one of the more inspiring stories. Oh, long story short, they won the British Eight. They won the Olympic gold in 2000. It's fascinating to watch that race. I didn't follow rowing until I heard about this story, but you can actually pull up the race from the Olympic Games and listen to the British commentators. God, it's great. Because the British led from wire to wire. And it's fascinating because the British commentators are like, there's no way they can sustain this pace. Oh, they're working way too hard. The off-season, this, that, back to this. And he goes, oh, they're going to fade for sure. Oh, they've been such abject failures their entire lives. Oh, my God. These guys are worthless. There's no, they're stretching out their leg. Oh, my God, they're going to win the gold medal. And it's just, for 10 minutes, it's just this great narrative of how bad they are and then how great they become. And so I would encourage you to read it. It's very motivating. But the bottom line is, if we know what our why is, identifying the how becomes a little bit clearer. They couldn't have come up with, will it make the boat go faster, until they could all agree we want to win the Olympic gold. The why defined the how.